I surrender. worship team. So wonderful to be in the presence of God this morning. Don't take your seats as yet. All right, take your seats. We just love Jesus. Amen. Such a glorious day to be in the presence of an almighty God. Do you know that today is a day that God gives gifts? If you follow the whole Testament, you'll find that on the day of Pentecost, the gift was given. And not only to the New Testament church, and I want to take you back to the Old Testament for a while. But before I do that, I'd like to welcome every single one of you into the presence of God. It's so wonderful to see the house full. All glory and praise to Jesus that he's blessing this house. I thank the Lord for my dear student, Mark Churaman. I taught in Unit 3 for 34 years. And Unit 3 is one of the most impoverished areas in Chatsworth and even in the whole of Durban. They had no pianos in those days and there were no keyboards. There was no cricket balls to play with. You used to have paper balls. And many of you would understand what I'm saying. Tomato box bats. And this child was raised in that environment. And as I used to be coming to my class every morning, piano used to be playing, because at that time the government used to give us pianos, and he played on that piano every single morning. Be there in the morning, never had his lunch, he'll be there during lunch break, playing and playing and playing and playing, and him and all his brothers are proficient musicians today, and I thank the Lord for him, and thank you for honoring me the way you did, Mark. I really appreciate that. I think you are one of the children that brought up the best in me. So God bless you and your family. And as you are with John Maxwell and going around the world and in Dubai, carry the favor of God. No matter how big you become, don't forget that it is Jesus that deserves all the glory and the honor and the praise. And so God bless you. And I know your time was very short and you chose to come and be with us. I thank you for that. Because sometimes the church needs to know where we come from. And we thank the Lord for that and for honoring us the way you did. God bless you and your dear wife. And we pray that you'd come back again. God bless you. And those of you that are here in the house, I thank you for your faithfulness. You know, I thank God for your tithes and offerings. You would know that this is one church where we'd never ask for a tithe or an offering. We don't do a presentation before offering. It was done so quietly this morning, I didn't even know the offering was taken. But I want to thank you for your tithes and for your love offering and your gifts. I want to tell you that this church has been renovated from every door handle, the varnishing, the curtains, the roof. It's just been a real wonderful walk with God. All the windows have been replaced. And we just thank the Lord for his blessings. To our council, to Ravi as a treasurer, sometimes he's very hard on us. Send us a message. What is that cash drawn for? What is this for? What is that for? Leon will get so irritated with Ravi. He'd say, I sent the thing already. But thank you, Ravi. Thank you. It's wonderful to have men of God and a council that the church is accountable to. And so we thank God for you and thank God for all that you're doing and thank God for the many blessings that we are receiving at Living Waters Church. And I want to tell you again, it's not about me or Cynthia. It's about Jesus and his timing. And to him be all the glory and the praise and the honor. Now when the wind picks up in Durban, we don't have to worry that a window will cave in because they're all brand new windows. And they really armor plated. And so we thank the Lord for that. I also want to ask this morning, there are many of you that have skills amongst us here. We really overuse Shivaska. Shivaska brings my tea, he will set up, he will run back up and do the recording, he'll post it on YouTube and all of that. But there are many of you sitting here and you're doing nothing. And I'm going to be hard on you. You have a gift in your hand. What are you doing with it? We need people to come forward. People are phoning me. Even Friday somebody said, Pastor, I'm desperate to watch your messages, but we're not getting the link. Now we do have a web page. If you go on the Living Waters Church site, what's it, Leon? Living Waters Church at co.za. You will pick up all the information of Living Waters Church. We paid a lot of money to get that site going. So please log on there, make your comments, watch those videos. But I'm speaking to all of you that are technologically blessed this morning. You that are IT technicians and you're sitting and doing nothing here. I want you to start getting involved. Help Shavaska. We need these messages recorded. We need our worship team recorded. We need to go out there, not because we want to be popular and want fame. We want to tell the world what true church is all about and who Jesus really is. I'm so tired of what churches are doing today, presenting a false gospel. We need to present the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this is how we can do it, through mass media. And so I know Jonathan is sitting here with an IT degree. There are many others that are sitting here. Those of you that have lights, I'm calling on you. Come, give us lights here for the recording of our music and recording of our messages. Those of you that have technical know-how, don't sit back and do nothing. God has blessed you, is endued you with a gifting. Shavaska does everything for this church, for everybody. He even bribes for every department. So that's overdoing it with Shavaska. And you know how thin he is because of running around. So I want you to please put your hands to the plow. Get involved. If God has given you a gift, please use that gift. And you know, I'm so really, really want to ask this morning that immediately after the service, won't you see Ravi, our treasurer? Tell him this is what I'd like to do in the church. I'm asking you, if you've got a video camera at home, give it to us. We can buy one if we want to buy one. But some of you have. Give it to us and say, Pastor, we will do the lighting. We will do the recording. Come on, we're a family. And I don't want to struggle. Shivaska is struggling from the back every week. They're recording from the back there. So therefore, we're not asking you for money. We're asking you for your expertise. To come and give us your expertise so that we can glorify God in a greater measure. Wouldn't it be wonderful if this message of Shavuot be broadcast throughout the world? We have people in Australia that are waiting for these messages. And so it will be so wonderful if we have proper lighting here for video. We have proper cameras. We have proper people doing that. So please, if God is speaking to you this morning, see Ravi, our treasurer. The reason why I asked you to see the treasurer, he knows how to get money out of you. No, this is about your expertise. See Ravi and say to him, Ravi, I'm willing to help. Jonathan, I'm putting your hand up for you. Number one, there are many of you here that God has endued with some gifting. Come and make it available to us. Now that I've done all that, clap your hands to say, yes, Pastor, I agree. See, even if you don't agree now, the person next to you is watching, so you have to clap your hands. Come, let's come together. Let's go out. Listen, we've got a donation of 200 Bibles, Errol, to be distributed at King George Hospital, at Addington Hospital. Somebody phoned me on Friday and said, Pastor, we're giving the church 150 Bibles. And Daniel, I know, gave us over 50 Bibles. So we have programs going on all over. We're feeding so many homes around. We are taking care of old age homes. Our ladies have knitted clothing for the children in the orphanages around. There's so much going on. Get involved. Put your hands to the plow and let God be glorified in this church. Somebody say amen. Won't you just stand in the presence of God? We're going to sing an old chorus. Sweep over my soul. Sweep. Sing it if you know it, church. Sweet Spirit, sweep over my soul. My journey is complete as I sit at Jesus' feet. Sweet Spirit, sweep over my soul. Your journey is complete not because you're over. Your journey is complete of trying without the Holy Spirit. And today we want to go with the Holy Spirit. Sweep over my soul. Sing it, church. Sing it like you've never sung it before. Sing it as a prayer unto God. Sweep over my soul. My journey is complete. Sweet Spirit, sweep over my. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. I just want to remind you that the word one is mentioned over 13 times in these chapters. One accord in one place. Where there is unity, God commands the blessing. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, and the Spirit gave them utterance. And they were dwelling at Jerusalem, Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? I want you to know this morning, as you take your seats, church, we are talking about Pentecost. We are talking about Shavuot. We are talking about harvest. We are talking about the Feast of Weeks. Many of us think that the Holy Spirit fell on the day of Pentecost. I've got news for you. I want you to listen very carefully to me as I teach you this morning that the Holy Spirit did not appear the first time on the day of Pentecost. There was a difference. During the time of Gideon, the Bible says, and the Holy Spirit clothed Gideon. The Hebrew word is labash. It clothed him. But in the New Testament, we find that there's an individual occurrence of cloven tongues of fire falling on each one of the believers. So was the Holy Spirit absent in the Old Testament and suddenly appeared in the New Testament. And yet we serve a triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You see, Jesus said, and even in the book of Corinthians, you will find this. He said, I leave with you a gift. When you go to the Jewish wedding, you learn so much of the scripture. And that's why I cannot understand why people don't want to understand the Old Testament and the Jewish festivals. Because if you do, it will throw so much of light into our understanding of where we are right now. When a Jewish groom leaves his bride and they've got to stay away from what for 1 week after the betrothal. The betrothal is a wedding ceremony. It is not an engagement like you and I get engaged. And understand the enormity of Mary having been married to Joseph and finds herself with child. That's the enormity of that situation. When the bridegroom leaves his bride, he leaves with her what is called matan. Matan is a gift. And this gift that he leaves with her, he says, I'm giving you this gift so that you will remember me. You will know how sweet and wonderful you as the bride are. Therefore, I find it fit to leave with you a gift. I give this to you so that in my absence, you will remember me. In my 7 days that I will not be with you, you will remember me. You will remember how sweet our relationship is. You will remember how wonderful our relationship is. Isn't this like Jesus, the bridegroom? In John 14:1, he says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. But my bride, whilst I am gone, I am leaving with you the matan. I am giving you a gift. So you will remember the sweetness of our relationship. What is the matan? It is the gift that Jesus gave to us. He says, I go, but I leave with you the comforter, Parakletos. I leave with you Shavuot. I leave with you Ruach HaKodesh, which means the Holy Spirit. I leave it with you, and I am going, but don't forget to remember me. Isn't that beautiful? When you look at Shavuot, as the Jews call it, or Pentecost, which is the English of the same thing, which means 50, we've got to go back to the Old Testament and understand where it's coming from. The Spirit of God moved upon the waters. You see, where the word is, the water, the Spirit of God covers it. And so we find right there in the book of Genesis, the Holy Spirit being present. And all through Scripture, we find the Holy Spirit being present. What happens is at Passover, the children of Israel are there. And God says, listen, I want you to bake your bread quickly, matzo. You will not use leaven, and you will put stripes upon it, and you will put piercings upon it, so that it will cook quickly, because you've got to leave in a hurry. The Jews did not know what they were doing. They were actually, because Jesus comes and he says, I am the bread of life. And Isaiah 53 says, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. So the bread of life is pierced. The bread of life takes stripes. And that's the matzo that was prepared. But what happens? God says, take the blood. Apply it upon the doorpost and the lintels of your homes. And when the death angel comes, he will pass over, because you will be covered and protected by the blood. 7 weeks, and that's why this is called the Festival of Weeks also. God says, count 7 weeks, 49 days. And on the 50th day, what happens to the children of Israel? They find themselves on Mount Sinai. What's so significant about Mount Sinai? It is a little hill. It is not a mountain. It says Mount Sinai, but it is not the biggest mountain. You see, God gives 613 laws to the Jews on this mountain. He also gave the Torah. And he says, you are my chosen people, but you're not chosen because I choose you and you are special. Oh no! You will go out and be a light to the world, and you will tell everybody that I am God. So 50 days later on Mount Sinai, the Torah and the Ten Commandments is given. That's the first Pentecost. That's where the Holy Spirit comes. And what happens? On that day, the Bible records that 3,000 souls were killed because they will not obey the law of God. In the book of Acts chapter 2, we find that Peter preaches and 3,000 souls are saved. You see, under law, there's death, but under grace, there's life. Hallelujah. We are living in grace today. When 3,000 souls were dead because they did not comply with the law, here we have in grace 3,000 souls when Peter preaches being saved. Somebody give the Lord some praise. 613 laws as such they have to follow. Do you know that the pomegranate has 613 seeds? Do you know that the Star of David is the pomegranate actually? God is so complete in everything he does. He's so perfect in everything he does. He's a beautiful God. That's why I love that song. You know, we were listening in the car as we were coming. What a beautiful name it is. And you sang it so beautifully. What a beautiful name it is. I love the line, my sin was great, but your love was greater. I love it. I want to say it again. My sin was great, but your love was greater. What a powerful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. I go, but I leave with you the Comforter. Don't forget that I love you. What does the Holy Spirit say to you? Don't forget that the one that is gone is coming again to receive you unto himself. He is the bridegroom. He has left with you a gift, and that gift is the matan. What is it? It is a blessing. A lot of us think it is only speaking in tongues. A lot of us think it is discernment and prophecy. I want to tell you, not so. Many of you have been skilled and anointed. That is the Holy Spirit. Many of you don't know, even in the building of the temple, God anointed craftsmen for the temple. In Exodus 40, it records, you shall anoint the implements of the temple and they shall be holy. And so therefore we have holiness, not only the way you see it, your wisdom, your resources, all of those things are blessed of God. Somebody say hallelujah. God gave the Torah. He gave the Torah and confirmed his promise in Jeremiah 31, 31 to 34. He says, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they broke, although I was an husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Why were two loaves waved at this feast of Pentecost or Shavuot? Why were two loaves waved? You see, the Jews didn't know why two loaves were waved. It was the waving of the sheaf they would wave. What was it? It was a feast of harvest. It was a harvest. In other words, when they took in their produce, they brought it to the temple and they waved it before the Lord. They waved these loaves before the Lord. You see, the two loaves represent the Jew and the Gentile. Why? A careful reading of the scripture will tell you that at the temple, when Jesus whipped those money changers, why did he whip them? Because they were on the ground of the Gentiles who were worshiping at the temple. But do you know that the Gentiles were not allowed inside of the temple? They were only allowed to worship outside of the temple. And when Jesus saw that, he said, you are making this a den of thieves, because these Gentile people are supposed to be worshiping outside of the temple. I love it when the Bible says, he tore the veil. Hallelujah. He tore the veil. And the Jew and the Gentile are no more separated. We have the mercy and the grace and the glory of an almighty God. No more are we outside the temple, but the veil in the temple has been torn in two. We have access to the very throne room of God, right into the Holy of Holies. You and I are not covered by the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit is in us. Hallelujah. Glory to God. What happened at Mount Sinai was a type of what happened in the New Testament. When you look at Passover, Jesus and Corinthians, Paul says Jesus is what? Our Passover lamb. You with me, everybody? Tell your neighbor, it's getting warm in here. Hallelujah! Come on! You want a demonstration of the Holy Spirit? Some of you get so quiet about the Holy Spirit. The Bible says the Holy Spirit came as a rushing mighty wind and filled all those that were in the house. They began to speak in new tongues. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit is gentle, but the Holy Spirit is not weak. The Holy Spirit is powerful. The Holy Spirit is powerful. Are you listening to me, church? Jesus comes and he fulfills the type of the Passover lamb in Egypt. Paul says he is our Passover lamb. Do you know that Jesus was crucified on exactly the same day that the lamb was killed in Egypt? Do you know that? He fulfills the feast of Passover, unleavened bread, and first fruits. He says, I am the first fruits of them that slept. What is the first fruit? The waving of the sheaf on Pentecost. He says, now you don't have to celebrate that in waving the sheaf, because I am now the bread of life. I am now to be celebrated. I am that Passover lamb. No more the blood of bulls. No more the blood of goats. I am your Passover lamb. No more is the Gentile church outside. We are part and parcel of the kingdom of God. We are generals and royal priesthood. We are not second-class citizens. We are children of an almighty God. Somebody give God glory and honor and praise. You are not outside. You are inside. Hallelujah. I've seen a lot of these Israeli soldiers, little puny things that are carrying these major weapons. I can tell you what, they might be small, they might be puny, but they're carrying powerful weapons. You might be small and insignificant, but you are carrying a powerful weapon. You are carrying a matan. You are carrying a gift, which is the Holy Spirit. You may look like nothing, but I want to tell you that with the power of the Holy Ghost, you are something. Tell your neighbor, I'm somebody, and say it with some attitude. Come on. All you husbands, be careful. Don't say that to your wives. You may not make it home. You see what happened there in Passover and Sinai. I don't know if you know how beautiful our God is. What happened there was a type. To this day, the Jews don't understand it. And when we have Jesus on Passover, whilst the priest in the temple was tying up the lamb to be crucified, Jesus was being nailed on the cross at the same time. When Jesus says, "It is finished," at exactly 3 o'clock, read your Bible carefully, the priest would kill the lamb in the temple. 50 days later, the Torah was given on Mount Sinai. What happens 50 days from Passover? What happens 50 days from Easter? What happens 50 days from the time of the crucifixion? And they were all gathered together in one accord, in one place, exactly like it happened on Mount Sinai. And what happened? What happened there? The Holy Spirit fell. What's the difference between Gideon and Samson? The Bible says the Holy Spirit came upon Samson, and that's a wonderful picture of physical strength and not being able to perform what God has called you to do. Samson was strong. He was so strong he could kill a lion. He could kill a bear. He was strong. But the Spirit of God, Labash, had left him. And when the Spirit of God had left him, he became weak. Gideon said in Judges 6, "I am the least of my brethren. Why do you choose me? I'm from the tribe of Manasseh." Don't you know that Manasseh is not a good group? You know, like in South Africa, the Fundamervas wear like tops in this country. If you're a Fundamerva, then you're a big boy. And so it was with the Indian caste system. You had a certain name. My surname, I come from the lowest caste in India. Amongst the lowest caste in India. I don't care. Because I'm royalty. Hallelujah. I'm royalty. Man tells you that you are nothing. You come from a low caste. You come from unit 3. You got no piano. You're playing cricket with a paper there. I'll tell you what. We are children of an awesome God. We are royal priesthood. We are a holy nation. We are prophets and priests and kings. You talk about racism. There's bigger racism in India than anywhere else in the world. If you're darker skinned, you got a problem. The lighter skinned ones are better off than the darker skinned ones. And when I go to heaven, I'm not going to ask Jesus to be fair, because all you white people, you take in more of that ultraviolet rays than I do. Praise the Lord. Let me tell you, all of this is nothing when you come under the power of the Holy Ghost. We are all one and all equal in the presence of an almighty God. We are a royal priesthood. We are princes and princesses in the kingdom of God. You are a nothing. Don't let anybody say that to you. Don't let anybody say you're worth nothing. You stand up. You put your shoulders back, and with some attitude, you tell them, "I am the child of a king." Hallelujah. Exactly what happened there in Sinai happened on the day of Pentecost. Leviticus 22, they are called the feasts of the Lord. People, you know, they ask me, "But Pastor, why you teach on the feast?" Because it's not Israel's feast. The word in Hebrew is moed. God says, "These are my feasts. This is convocations, my timing." I want to ask the question, how did Jesus fulfill the feasts exactly on the day? Passover, unleavened bread. He says, "I'm the first fruits of them that slept." And then we have first fruits at Pentecost. Then we have tabernacles. I ask you to watch the feasts and learn the feasts, because I believe that those feast days are very significant. And God's going to fulfill that type. And if you know what the type is, then you will know the fulfillment of the type. Somebody say hallelujah. You see, Israel was under Egyptian bondage. And Paul says, we are under the bondage of sin. And with the Holy Spirit, we're no longer under the bondage of sin, but we are free. You see, when you have the Holy Spirit on you, there's a change. What happened to Gideon? When he was clothed with the Holy Spirit, the same fearful man that was there at the spring, what did he do? You know what he does? He says, I want you to send all those people home and just keep 300. And you know how he chose the 300? The ones that are most fearful. The ones that were looking and drinking. He said, yeah, those are the ones I want. Those that were they had their heads in the ground and they were drinking. He said, no, those are too brave for me. I want the ones that are frightened. And he chose them and he says, these are the ones I will use. And what happens with Gideon? The power of God comes upon Gideon. And he defeats the enemy. What happens with Samson? He says, Lord, give me this power one more time. And he breaks down those pillars with the power of God. Could he do it with his physical strength? No. He could do it with the Holy Ghost. Some of us need the Holy Ghost in our lives to start to live again, to start to breathe again, to start to feel again. Two loaves. You are part and parcel of the church. Acts 1:8. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses. You don't receive the Holy Spirit just to be happy somewhere, because it doesn't make any sense. You receive the power to go and tell the world that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. The Bible says in Acts 2:41, then they that gladly received the word were baptized. And the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. You see, when you preach under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, something must happen. Something must be different. Let's look at David. Psalm 51 verse 10. You say the whole Testament didn't have the Holy Spirit. No, we did. The Holy Spirit came upon Gideon. The Holy Spirit came upon Samson. What about David? Psalm 51 verse 10. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Hallelujah. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Don't worry about these young people. They want to make money. They're disturbing us. Leave them. What about Moses in the wilderness? Moses was crying, God, you gave me all these people. They're mumbling. They're grumbling about everything. They want meat. Did I bear them? Did I conceive them? Moses is asking God, who are these people that you gave to me? I'm fed up of them. I'm over 80 years of age. I'm tired. God says, hold on. And I love Moses' father-in-law, Jethro. Hey, come here. He calls him. Take your wife. Take your children. Ministry is good for you, but don't forget your wife and your children. So he says, take your wife and children and go. Good father-in-law. And then he says, Moses, God calls Moses. Moses, come here. Call 70 people. Watch this. The spirit that is in you, I'm going to pass on to the 70 so that they will help you because you can't manage on your own. You see, some of you need to delegate responsibility. You know why I'm strong in this church? Because I've men of God that are strong. All the matters that of administration and everything else, they just do it. They tell me, Pastor, you worry about the spiritual thing, we'll do everything else. And I'm so secure because I trust them and I know how loyal they are to the things of God. What about you? You need to delegate responsibility. Don't say, I'm tired. Not about physical labor, but about the Spirit of God that you need to pass on to others. Moses, the spirit that is in you. What spirit? Was it a human spirit? It was the Holy Spirit. I now am going to give to those 70 elders. David, take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Don't you ever think that the Holy Spirit appeared on the day of Pentecost. What was the difference? The difference was labash. They were clothed with the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah, I love it.
But you and I have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of us. And when you understand the scriptures and you read the word that we have for dwelling in is not the word that we have for clothed. And so the Holy Spirit dwells within us. We are the other loaf that was waved on the day of Pentecost. We are the Gentile people, but we have the Holy Spirit in us. What was the difference? They spoke in other tongues on the day of Pentecost. And in my reading, in our reading, we saw that people understood in their languages. So what was it? It was the birth of the church. Are you listening to me? Where languages and people and nations were included because of the church. Before this, the Holy Spirit fell on who? Only the Jews. Are you with me, everybody? It was Gideon, it was Samson, it was David. Saul. He said, I'm of the tribe of Benjamin. One of the least of the tribes. How can you anoint me as king? And God said to Samuel, Samuel, I'm going to send a man that's taller than everybody else. He's more handsome than anybody else. And Samuel, I want you to anoint this man as king. And when Saul goes there, he wants to seek a seer. Somebody's going to tell him about the future. But God has already spoken to Saul. And God says to Saul, anoint that man as king over Israel. You might be from the tribe of Benjamin. You might be from the tribe of Manasseh. You might be a real write-off. But let me tell you, in the kingdom of God, I love it. There are no write-offs. In the kingdom of God, every single one of you that is seated here today, every one of you is special. Hallelujah. You are a child of God Almighty. Don't worry about popular opinion. I love President Trump. I'm not talking politics. He said to this guy at CNN, you keep quiet. You don't talk. You are useless at reporting. You report false news. No matter what they throw at this man, I know one thing I celebrate him for is that he celebrates Israel. That's why I like him. Because he's chosen for this moment. And I'm not asking you to follow me. I'm just making a statement. I'm coming to an end. There's Jephthah in Judges 11, chapter 1. You read that Jephthah was born of a woman who was a prostitute. Are you listening to me? The Bible says he was the son of a prostitute, a harlot. And what happens? The brothers that were born to this family, they chased him out and said, go away. You are born of another woman. You cannot stay in our house. But when the Ammonites came against them, they went looking for Jephthah. They said to him, please come and help us. And the Bible records in 11:29, and the Spirit of God came upon him and he won the war. Let me tell you something today. You might be an orphan. You might have been written off, but God does not write you off. This guy was born of a prostitute, but yet God chooses him to liberate Israel. Look at Ezekiel 37. Ezekiel has a vision. He sees a whole lot of dry bones. These bones got no life. They are dead. There's nothing in these bones. And he hears a rattling. He hears a rattling. And what happens? The bones come together. And there is the sound of Ruach HaKodesh. You know what's Ruach? When you see it in Hebrew, it sounds like the wind. Ruach, the wind, it comes. And what happens? It settles on these bones. The flesh and the sinews come together. And these dry bones start to live again. Beloved people of God, I want to tell you, you might seem dry. You might seem there's no flesh on you. But there's a move of the Holy Spirit of God that is coming. That's going to breathe life into dead bones. No more will you be dead, but you're going to live again. You're going to be alive again. Tell your neighbor, there's hope for me. Come on. Llewellyn, don't act like you got a neighbor, please. If I were you, I'd go sit next to somebody and give them a nice one and say, there's hope for me.
Hallelujah.
Hey, tell your neighbor with some attitude, there's hope for me. If that's the attitude to display, the devil will be so excited.
Say it with some attitude, there's hope for me. Yeah. You might seem dead and dry. Your family might be in pieces. Your children might have walked away. Your husband might have walked away. Your finances might have hit rock bottom. You may be going to apply for an overdraft. I've got news for you. The Holy Spirit is able to put life into anything that is dead. Come on. Those of you that are sitting with kidney problems and backache and all those emotional problems, oh, those dry bones, beloved people, there's hope. The dry bones shall live again. Hallelujah. I'm closing. In Isaiah 61, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. What happened with Jesus from age 12 to 30? No sign of him. After John baptizes him, we see and hear of him again. Isaiah says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Even Jesus had to wait for an injection of the Holy Spirit before he started his ministry. I want to tell you this, beloved people. You cannot live without the Holy Spirit. If you think you're going to make it because you're intelligent, you're not going to make it. Samson had the strength, couldn't do it. Gideon, weak, frail. I'm of the tribe of Manasseh. Set a fleece before the Lord, tested the Lord. But when the Holy Spirit clothed him, he was able to take down the Midianite army. There were thousands of them there, but God needed the most fearful. Let me tell you, when you're on the street, there's a massive 22-wheeler coming, massive truck coming. And behind that, there's another truck and another truck. A little puny policeman goes there. He puts out his hand and stops that 22-wheeler. Because he does not have the strength to stop that truck. But the power that is invested in him through the law of the country causes him to stop that truck. You might seem weak and puny and cannot stop an avalanche. But there's a power in you that comes from God Almighty that nothing must stop you. I want you today to walk in the authority of the Holy Ghost. God gave you a gift. Jesus said, I leave with you the Comforter. Do a study on the Jewish wedding, on the ancient Jewish wedding. It is just too beautiful. And he says, I leave with you the Matan. Do you know that the father of the bridegroom has to give the bride a gift? Do you know that? He has to give the family a gift. And you know, in Jewish weddings, the families marry each other. It's just not two individuals. I love it. Because this family will marry the family of God. Hallelujah. He says, I am your husband. And I am your husband and you are my bride. Song of Solomon. We all say, what a lovely love story. No, it's not. It's a love story of the bridegroom for his bride. Ephesians 5:25, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave his life for it. But I speak concerning the church. This is the mystery, Paul says. Revelation 19:7, the marriage supper of the Lamb, the marriage of the church and Jesus Christ. In the meantime, what do? We have the power of the Holy Ghost. Those of you that are hurting and in pain, won't you just stand? I want to sing that old chorus. Mark, you come play for me, right? We'll sing I Surrender, right? Not the new one, the old one. Let me just show this church what I taught you, right? All to Jesus I surrender. Huh? Just the keyboard. You know what? Give it up to Jesus this morning. Do you hear my heart? My heart is that, you know what? You love Jesus. That you will give up trying. Raise your white flag and say, I give up. An international act of surrender is to pick up your white flag. The only people that will still shoot you with your white flag raised up is the Muslims, but never mind. Pick up your white flag and say, God, I've tried so hard. I've fasted. I've prayed. I've done everything that I could possibly do, but I'm still in the situation that I was in before. You see, God wants to bring you to a place where you will say, my all in all is in Him. It's not what you get from Him. It's not who you are. But if you can submit totally to Him and say, Lord, you can take everything, but give me Jesus. Take everything, but give me Jesus. You will be at a point where the Holy Spirit will come and take over. Sometimes the Holy Spirit has to force you into that situation. He has to force you. It takes everything away from you. I was sitting at the market on Friday. I have a number plate that's personalized. So this guy comes to me and he says, hey, how's it, Chris? I say, hi, how are you? He says, you forgot me. I said, looking at him. He says, I'm Sandy's son. Thinking, now, hey, I didn't visit my relatives for so long. Maybe this fellow is one auntie's son. He says, yeah, you remember we played together, we had fun together. And thinking, I don't know this fellow. Then I realized he's pulling a fast one on me. Somebody did that to my brother-in-law. They said, hey, how's it, Joe? And his name happened to be Joe. He said, how's Amma? And he said, no, she's okay, and all the rest of it. He said, you know what, I'm really stuck for bus fare. Can you give me 20 rand? He gave it. You know what I'm trying to tell you? In a serious moment, lightheartedly, you'll have a lot of counterfeit Holy Spirits. You'll have a lot of people pretending. I watched a preacher, a lady preacher, this morning, YouTube. She was shouting and ranting and raving and screaming and jumping and doing everything, talking about the Holy Spirit. And then suddenly the whole atmosphere changed. You see, I ask you humbly, the Holy Spirit is not it. It is not a performer. The Holy Spirit is a person. The Holy Spirit is your friend. Jesus said, I go, but I leave with you a gift. And the gift that I leave with you is to tell you that I love you till I see you again. Won't you stand in the presence of God? All to Jesus I. Manessa, come play the sax for me. All to Him I feel. I will ever love and trust Him. on every husband to take the hand of his wife. I want families to join hands today. And if you're alone, that's fine. I want you to know that you are being hugged by the Holy Spirit. Don't feel alone. I want you to feel the embrace of the Holy Spirit. He loves you. He wants to walk with you and talk with you and give you wisdom and give you resources, give you understanding and give you power. Every marriage that is broken, I command in the name of Jesus by the Holy Spirit that it be fixed in Jesus' name. Every broken relationship, I pray, will be mended in Jesus' name. Everyone that is not well, there's so many that are not well. Sarah's, Rohini's aunt, all those, Anna, everyone that's not well. I command in the name of Jesus that there shall be healing. I pray that the house shall be healed in Jesus' name. I pray that the Holy Spirit will touch you this morning. The Holy Spirit will touch you. The fire of God will burn up the dross. Oh, hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody give God some praise. Somebody give God some glory. Somebody give God some honor. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. And the power of the Holy Ghost in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Somebody give the Lord some praise. Go in the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Amen.